importance of addressing child marriage, how it relates to other issues, but also to facilitate learning among members about what it will take to end child marriage. So I apologize for any confusion in people finding the room, because we had a last minute change of room in order that we could have the interpretation in this room. But I'm glad you all made it here, and this is obviously a very popular session. You're all very welcome. What we wanted to talk about during today's session is looking at what some of the evidence is related to solutions to ending child marriage, and talk about a number of case studies which have been showing really positive approaches and results. And learn a little bit more about what are some of the lessons that we can take from them for other programs going forward. The way that we'll kind of structure this is we'll start with a panel discussion and hear a little bit more about these different initiatives, and then we'll have a little bit of group work, because this is a 90-minute session when I think many of us would like much longer to discuss this. But what we'd like to think about as well, what are the ways going forward that we can continue this learning from different programs and what's working, and how do we translate that? How do we take some of the lessons that are being learned and help use them to help strengthen our programs? And so, you know, well, we've built into the agenda some time, both kind of to discuss the content, but we want to have, like, throughout this whole meeting, an opportunity to discuss, you know, process in going forward, and how do we take this going forward, and how do we work together in learning. So that's why we have a very specific group discussion and group work towards the end of this that we'll be looking at. Maybe just to start, I'll introduce you to our panel. We have Annabel, who's the Country Director of Population Council Ethiopia, and she's a leading expert on the issue of child marriage in Africa. She's going to talk specifically about the Berhani Hewan program and some of the research that came and evidence that came out of that. And also the work that she's been doing in continuing to build the evidence base in sub-Saharan Africa, and looking particularly at which interventions of among the package of interventions are proving to be the most effective. We also have Priya, who is the Group Director of Social and Economic Development at International Center for Research on Women. And again, she's a leading researcher on issues related to gender equality and social change, economic development. And ICRW, many of you will know, have a number of years ago did a mapping of what the different evidence and program evaluations that there were, and what some of the evidence coming out of that was. And they're also evaluating a major cash transfer program in India called the Apni Beti Apna Dan program. So we're delighted she's here to talk to us about that. Molly Melching, founder and director of Tostan. She's lived in Senegal for 40 years and founded Tostan, she was telling me, 25 years ago, your 25th anniversary. Many of you know Tostan has been working on child marriage and FGM for about 20 years and has done really impressive work in this area. And not forgetting Matthew Joseph from Pathfinder in India, and who also has years of experience working in family planning and reproductive health, child health, and he'll be sharing some lessons from the Prachar program that Pathfinder worked on in Bihar, and that process of scaling up over the last few years. So, without further ado, I suppose one other thing that I'd like to mention is I reached out to many of you in advance to hear what do people really want to know with this session? What do you really want to learn in this session? And I thank you for all of your inputs, because they've helped to guide some of the framing questions that I'm going to be discussing here today. And there was a lot of questions to cover. We won't get to all of them, but many of the questions that you raised on specific issues will also be covered throughout the rest of the program. So I hope that, you know, with this session we can uncover, you know, what is the evidence, and what's that showing us. What works and what hasn't worked. These are the kinds of things that you asked for. So I thank you for your input in advance, and those are the kind of questions that we're going to be discussing. But I'd just like to start by asking each of the panelists to introduce the initiative. What did it entail? What were the main elements of it? What kind of results were seen, and what do you think is distinctive about it that other people in the room would be interested to hear about? So I'll start with you, Annabel.
Okay, I'll speak for a few minutes about our roughly two generations of work on child marriage. So starting about 15 years ago, we started the program called Burhani Hawan in Ethiopia, and this means light for Eve in Amharic. And it was a program both to delay marriage in child marriage hotspots and also to support girls who are already married. This was a partnership between the Population Council, the Ethiopian Ministry of Women, Children, and Youth Affairs, UNFPA, UNF, and the Nike Foundation. And the original Burhani Hawan was designed as a package of interventions. And it was designed based on formative research as well as discussions with key stakeholders in these rural areas of Ethiopia. So it was also designed to address the various drivers of child marriage. So to address social norms, we did community conversations at the community level. We also provided girls with very modest amount of school supplies to take advantage of the protective effect of schooling. In addition, we offered a conditional cash transfer to address the economic drivers of child marriage. So we offered girls and their families a goat to delay marriage during the pilot phase of the program. And then finally, we implemented safe spaces mentoring groups, and these were particularly popular among married girls. And within these groups, girls got reproductive health information, life skills, and then were also offered a subsidized clinic card in case she wanted clinical services. And very importantly, as well as the subsidized clinic card, she was offered accompaniment, because very often in these rural areas, the clinic is at a great distance, and girls that young may be a bit too scared to go on her own. This first phase of Burhani Hawan was a quasi-experimental research design with baseline and endline surveys, and it proved to be extremely successful, particularly among the younger girls. So at endline, girls in the Burhani Hawan project were 1/10 as likely to be married and 3 times more likely to be in school compared to their counterparts in the control area. And very importantly, married girls were 3 times more likely to be using family planning at endline. So this really did demonstrate, this first generation demonstrated it is possible to do something to prevent child marriage in a modest amount of time. However, there were lingering concerns about the cost and scalability of the program. So as I said, this is a multi-component program. Some of our partners were worried, will we be able to scale this up over large populations? What exactly is the cost? We had not collected rigorous cost data. And this is a valid concern, because we're working in Ethiopia. It's a place where the problem is massive. So we will have over 5 million girls who are married as children in this generation. And while our prevalence is going down, our absolute numbers are going up because of population growth. So it was very important that we address these questions of the minimum essential package and cost and scalability. So we moved to our second generation work on child marriage. I call it Burhani Hawan 2, and this was supported by USAID. And the aim of this generation of work was to identify the minimum scalable package. So can a single intervention be effective in delaying child marriage, or can a more minimal intervention be effective in delaying child marriage? In this iteration of the work, we're doing the work not only in rural Ethiopia, we're also doing this work in Tabora, Tanzania, in western Tanzania, and in Burkina Faso in the Cascade region. And my colleague Giselle is here from our Population Council Burkina office. In this iteration of the work, we're testing these approaches we're testing these single component interventions. So in one Wareda, we have community, one district or Wareda, we have community conversations. In another district, we'll offer the school supplies. And yet a third district, we offer the conditional cash transfer. We still have the comprehensive or full model, and then we have a control area. And again, we're measuring the impact through population-based surveys, and very importantly, measuring the cost of interventions. Throughout this process, every 6 months, we measure the coverage of interventions to see what percentage of eligible girls are taking part in our schemes. And this is very important because these are remote rural areas. You often don't reach into the farthest, most remote place in these regions. So we are measuring cost and coverage. And what we're finding is that the more complex interventions have less coverage than do the single interventions. So single interventions have better coverage in our data. We're also, as I say, we're prospectively measuring the cost of interventions. So cost per girl served per year, as well as cost effectiveness when we combine that with the impact data. One of the things that we've learned from the Ethiopian arm of the study is that many people assume community norm change interventions are the cheapest, like our community conversations. Well, in this case, the cost per girl served, it's not the cheapest. It's about on par with the conditional cash transfer. In our Ethiopia arm of this study, the cheapest intervention per girl served is the provision of modest school supplies to keep her in school. In terms of our actual results of which interventions had the greatest impact on the age at marriage, we have the preliminary findings for Ethiopia and Tanzania. For Burkina Faso, those findings will be coming out next year. What we find is what is effective for younger to prevent the marriages for younger girls is different than what is effective to prevent the marriages for older girls. So in Ethiopia, the most effective interventions to prevent under 15 child marriage are community conversation and provision of school material. Those, however, are not effective in Ethiopia to prevent the marriages of girls 15 to 17. What has been effective is the conditional cash transfer. So, you know, that stands to reason because people might see their younger girls as more of school-going age, whereas the older girls, you know, people start to worry they might miss the marriage market, and therefore you need the more intensive economic interventions. What was effective in Tanzania among the older girls was the conditional cash transfer, and with really not much effective in preventing the marriage of the younger girls, in part because of the trends in our study region in Tanzania. What we learned, we're now also looking at cost effectiveness, which is combining the cost data with the impact data. And what we're learning is, obviously it's more cost effective or it's cheaper per marriage delayed among the older girls, the 15 to 17, because those girls, a larger number of them get married in that age range compared to the cost effectiveness among the younger girls. So it's cost per marriage delayed is more expensive among the under 15s, in part because it's a more rare event in these communities. What that has taught us is that we are now developing a low-tech diagnostic tool at the local level to be able to really pinpoint these very high prevalence child marriage hotspots for our eventual upscaling of this work. And as I say, our results for Burkina Faso will be coming out next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Annabel. And we'll definitely come back to some of the lessons that you're learning there. I mean, Priya, why don't we go to you? Let's go to India next and hear about a very different kind of cash transfer program that, from what I understand, didn't specifically set out to address child marriage, but you're looking at what the impact of it been. Can you explain a little bit more about what the program looked like?
Thanks. So the program we are evaluating is a conditional cash transfer program that a government in a particular state of India had set up in 1994. So it was really the first conditional cash transfer program in India, which had a very explicit objective, which was to enhance value of girls in society or in that state at that time. And the condition that was associated with the conditional cash transfer program was delayed marriage to 18. So the idea was not, the objective was not to delay age of marriage, but it was a condition that was linked with the cash, was to delay age of marriage at 18. So the way the CCT worked is that it was targeting all girls in all vulnerable poor households of Haryana, this particular state in northwest of India. As long as you met the eligibility criteria of vulnerability, which meant you were very poor or you belong to a particular caste category, you were eligible to uptake the scheme. And it was meant for the first, second, or third born daughter of a household. So not beyond number third birth order, but any first, second, or third daughter that was born at that time when the scheme was developed. When I say scheme, it's the CCT that I'm talking about. So when the program was developed, a girl who was enrolled by her parents in the program was given a bond in her name that would mature to amount of $500 when she turned 18. And if she remained unmarried at 18, her parents and she could encash that money, proving that she was unmarried. At that time, when the program was developed, the average or the median age of marriage was about 16 years or 15, less than 16 years. So in one stroke, the government at that time, the Women and Child Development Department of the government, thought that this basically will help delay the age of marriage to 18, but also would incentivize the birth of the daughter. Now, why was that important? Because in Haryana, in this particular state, as maybe some of you know, we have the problem of declining sex ratio, which means that there are not enough girls born to 1,000 boys that are born in society. So India, China, Vietnam, and several other countries, South Korea has managed to reverse that trend. We have the issue of sex selection or prenatal sex determination and then followed by elimination of a girl because that's the unwanted sex. So the objective of the scheme, of the program, was to really change the value of girls in society, to motivate families to have girls, and that's why the program was developed. Now, the reason we evaluated the program, this was the same grant that Annabel talked about from USAID that we at ICRW applied to study this program, was that we really wanted to understand, does it delay age of marriage? So when the program was developed in 1994, the first set of girls who would turn 18 in 2012. So when we wrote this proposal or thought about this evaluation, it was 2010, and we said, oh, wouldn't it be great? This will be the first time we can actually see whether a long-term protracted payment to the age of 18 years does really delay age of marriage. And I think that's a really interesting question, because currently many of these financial incentive programs, if you're doing them right now, you'll have to wait 18 years to see the effect on the outcome that you're interested in. So this gave us a very natural experiment to actually see whether the CCT or whether any financial incentive of this nature really changed behavior of parents to delay age of marriage. So the program, as I said, is across the state. It was universal in its application. We studied it in four districts, and we did a universal listing of all households who were eligible in those districts. So we listed 110,000 households and identified 10,000 girls who were eligible. Around 4,500 of them had enrolled in the program and the rest had not. Because while the application was universal, some people took it up and some didn't. Because maybe at that time you didn't have the documents to prove your particular status or your poverty status to apply for the program. So we now have a data set of about 10,000 girls where we interviewed them when before they turned 18, when they were 15, 16, and then after they turned 18, to look at whether the program has been successful in delaying the age of marriage of girls who were enrolled compared to those who were not enrolled. So that's basically what the evaluation is. And just also want to say that there was no other component of the government program. There was this bond that was given to you. You might store it in your rice can or under your mattress for 18 years. And then 18 years later, you can go and encash it as long as you can prove the girl is unmarried. There is no behavior change communication that happens over 18 years. And it's really like this long-term protracted payment. Now, there are a lot of secular shifts that are happening in 18 years. People are either getting poorer or richer. Maybe there are more schools in your neighborhood that have been constructed. All of those shifts are happening. In our survey, we've measured everything that could possibly be affecting the outcome, as well as looked at how attitudes and aspirations of households are changing. So we've really tried to do a very composite analysis. In our theory of change, we look at how can this conditional cash transfer really change this behavior? So we really look at many other things that might be changing, including your attitudes towards boys and girls in your household, your aspirations for your daughters, whether the schools have got constructed, whether the quality of schools has improved, etc. So what we are finding is, very interestingly, I mean, I would love to get a show of hands if people think that this kind of a program could have affected the outcome. How many of you think it could have affected the age of marriage? You haven't ever seen the money for 18 years, you have a piece of paper, and you believe that the government is going to pay you and you delay age of marriage. So how many of us said yes? Great. So I also am a very optimistic person, and I'm with you, the optimist in the room. It has. It's very interesting. We've seen the effect of girls who were enrolled both on school completion, secondary school completion, as well as on the age of marriage. And we are finding that beneficiary girls are 24% more likely to complete secondary school compared to eligible non-beneficiary girls. And this is controlling for everything, selection bias, et cetera. It's a very econometric analysis. And they're 11% less likely to be married before the age of 18. So it's a very interesting result that we are finding of this conditional cash transfer program on parents' behavior. But I do want to tell you one last thing before I pass this, that the reason we think this is happening is it's a very instrumental effect. This money that you delay your daughter's marriage is very useful to pay for her marriage expenses, pay for dowry. So there's a very instrumental effect that might be motivating you to shift your behavior, get your daughter married as soon as she turns 18, get the money and pay for her wedding and pay for her dowry. And I'm going to stop at that because I know you'll give us a chance to talk more.
Absolutely. I think you've raised some really good points. Thanks, Priya. We'll pick up on them again. And let's go to Senegal and hear about your approach, Molly. And can you tell us, you know, what your approach is? What do you think is important for other people to hear about how your work with Tostan has developed?
Okay, thank you. As you said, it's been 25 years. So our program has evolved greatly. I think many of you know about our program. We are a non-governmental organization. We're headquartered in Dakar, Senegal. And our program has been implemented in 8 African countries, currently 6 in West Africa, but we were also in Somalia and Djibouti. We do the program. We've developed it over this 25 years. It is, again, it has evolved to really take into account the lessons learned over the years. We do the program in 22 African languages, always doing the program, the three-year program, in the language of the people with whom we are working. And we have reached over 200,000 participants directly, but really millions of people indirectly. And this is because the program, which involves actual classes, it's a really, we consider it to be an alternative education program, particularly for girls and women, adolescent girls and women who have never been to school or who else dropped out at age 12 or early on, and did not even receive enough education to really make a difference in making decisions, important decisions, about their families and communities. So it provides information on democracy, on human rights and responsibilities, on problem solving, on hygiene and health. All of that is over a one-year period. And the second and third year periods are devoted to literacy learning, math, project management, because we do seek results in governance, in education, in economic growth, and also in the environment, and of course in health. So our strategy has been, and one that has worked very well, I think many of you know that Tostan early on discovered the importance of understanding the nature and dynamics of social norms. And so we have what we call an organized diffusion strategy, which means that our classes are given and the participants who are directly involved commit to adopting a learner in the community during the whole program. And then the class itself commits to adopting the whole community. And so they reach out to everyone else in the different neighborhoods through class theater, songs, poetry. We always use traditional African songs and poetry and theater, things people love to do and really get engaged in presenting to the rest of the community to open up conversations with the rest of the community on the issues that are brought up in class. But then they also reach out, the communities reach out to other communities to which they are interconnected. Because we have found that has been one of the most strategic lessons learned. That even in when you reach a whole community, they cannot abandon certain practices such as child marriage and female genital cutting without including their entire social network. Because they do not just marry in their community, they marry in other communities where they have relatives or people with whom they do intermarry. And if those people are not included in this program and on with this information and involved in the dialogue, then they will not be willing, perhaps they will put social pressure and be angry if people make a decision without including them in these important decisions. And that has often led to the public declarations for the abandonment of child marriage and female genital cutting in West Africa and then in Somalia and Djibouti, which we have experienced over the years. The first one was in 97. That was with one community, and this is where we learned that one alone does not work. After that, we got lots of feedback from our participants who explained to us that just one alone cannot work. You have to reach out to the intermarrying communities. So since 1997, we have had over 7,000 communities publicly declare their intention to abandon these practices. And I will say, we know that it is not 100%. We have had evaluations. Perhaps the most important was done in 2006 and 2007, and looked back at all the communities that had abandoned 10 to 8 years earlier. And they found that of those communities that had been through the program, who had done the declarations, that at 70% had abandoned, about 70% had really abandoned and had maintained that decision over the years. In a recent evaluation of the DHS studies done by the government of Senegal, they looked at not the women who were cut, this is for female genital cutting, not for child marriage. But they did find a very significant drop among the daughter data. They said there was, among those who said that they had cut at least one of their daughters, between the 2005 and 2010 DHS studies, there was a drop of 69%. So we do feel like using this social norm approach is working, but also from what we're seeing in the field. We are seeing communities reacting when a family wants to marry their daughter at 12 or 13, take them out of school. We have what we call the community management committees. These are established when Tostan goes into the community, and they are very active, not only during the program, but it's the element that constitutes the sustainability of our program. These community management committees, when these type of things happen, the practices occur, they react immediately. And many times when there have been child marriages planned, they have intervened, often doing marches, peaceful marches. They have gone to see the people involved. They have negotiated with them. And this has led, in many cases, to the abandonment of the child marriage that had been planned. And so we see this happening throughout the communities where we're working. And we also have seen, for example, I just was in Goudiri in the eastern region of Senegal. And I think one of the exciting things that has come out of our program, the fact that we do so much education on democracy and human rights, is that in the 55 villages where we're working in Goudiri, in the recent elections in Senegal, we had 63 Tostan participants elected to the rural council. 41 of those were women. And in discussing with them, they said, one of our major concerns and the advocacy that we are now doing within the rural council is to make sure that we get those educational structures we need, to make sure that our girls stay in school. They are working on all these human rights, health services, and keeping girls in school and trying to prevent child marriages. And I think this is something I hadn't really thought about, and I realize it's so important to get more women involved in these positions of power and exercising their, they know they have the right to speak out for the first time. They know that they can advocate for this. And they have the confidence. That's what I think is really critical in this. And just to add that, I would just add that we are very concerned about doing more evaluation of our programs. And we're very lucky we now have the Gates Foundation accompanying us to do monitoring and learning in 150 communities where we're working. And from that, we are discussing all these very complex issues, because so much of what we're doing involves systemic change, really changing mindsets, and this is hard to evaluate. And we also know this is a slow, sometimes process that does take more than just a seminar or a year or 2 years. It can be even longer. So we're trying to figure out how we can best evaluate the empowerment of girls and women. And hopefully we will have more information for you on that next year.
Great. Thank you, Molly. Matthew, over to you. You're going to tell us about the Prachar program in India. Again, not one which specifically was intended to address child marriage, but which had interesting results.
Yeah. So Prachar means promote in Hindi. So this is actually a behavior change program targeted at adolescents and young adults. And the three objectives that we have, two were direct objectives and one was indirect. The indirect one was to delay the age of marriage until 18 years. And what we directly worked for was to delay the first birth until the mother is 21 and space second and subsequent births for at least 36 months. So this program was implemented in one of the toughest geographies in India, a place called Bihar, with a population of about 100 million. and predominantly rural. And the program was implemented from 2001 to the last phase, the third phase of it ended in 2012. So over this three phases of intervention, Prachar had actually modified and adapted itself to the changing needs and the lessons that we are learning along the way. The first phase, based on formative research that we did, targeted every approach that came into our minds, like it was an omnibus program. We targeted young adults, we targeted newly married couples, and the results actually were significant. Then the second phase, we thought, okay, what actually worked among these strategies? You can't go up and scale a program with multiple strategies. And we actually segmented the area again, geographies again, and implemented some strategies in some areas and saw which had a better impact. And the third stage, we moved away from a purely NGO model where we worked with our own staff and having our own NGO partners to collaboration with the government, where the government frontline workers were roped in to address some of our field level activities. And of course, that was challenging to a larger degree. And at this point of time, we are in the fourth phase of Prachar, and I've been warned, I've been prohibited from calling it Prachar anymore because it's been so much transformed from the earlier program, though of course the key lessons learned are applied to these programs. And one of them is in a state of Haryana, where we are working with a very unique population, which the district that we're working in is supposed to be the worst performing in across all health indicators in the country. And even in Bihar, we have moved on to a purely technical assistance role where the activities of the program will be implemented by the government of the state. So in the three phases that we've completed and thoroughly evaluated, we actually reached out to different segments of the society. One is, of course, the adolescents, aged between 12 to 14 and 14 to 19 in two different groups of trainings. We imparted, actually it was more of a participative training that the adolescents went through, followed by interventions directed at their parents, at various gatekeepers, religious leaders. We even had interventions with boys in the community, and that is a unique part of Prachar, where boys were interacted through men volunteer or boy volunteers in the community. The results, yes, we saw that those adolescents exposed to Prachar married 2.6 years later than those who are not. And that was a startling result, actually, which led to several other interventions taking off. And the best part was a recent Pop Council study showed that they went back to the areas that we intervened 5 to 8 years earlier and found that the behaviors are still sustaining in the program areas when compared to the comparison areas. So in a nutshell, that's Prachar.
Great. Thank you, Matthew. And now, maybe just to open up a conversation and discussion with you all, one of the questions that I know people are really keen to hear about and had sent in advance is, what doesn't work? We've heard a lot about what works, but it's important for us as well to be reflecting on, you know, what didn't work, where did we make mistakes, and how did we, you know, seek to address them? And I'll just open it up to whoever would like to comment on it.
Okay, you want to start again, or do you want
to? So, what actually we found was not really working was the norm change didn't happen among the most vulnerable in the community. the changes happened among other communities, but in some castes and some groups, which were really vulnerable, we couldn't find that change happening. And so actually we are addressing that community particularly in the coming phase so that we can see what we can change. We can specifically target them and see how it works. Secondly, what we found was that in the third phase, especially working with the government, we realized that a less robust intervention, especially that happens when we involve the government because of its lack of direct control there, is that less robust interventions and of shorter durations. We in NGO sector, we work on a certain timelines, whereas that's not realistic in the government framework. Sometimes the delays go on to a year's due, and with that short implementation period, you tend to have poor results, and that we saw.
Okay, yes, I think the biggest lesson we learned and where we had the most change was in putting human rights education, human rights and responsibilities, that was critical, into our program. It was so important that we changed our whole program around in 2000, and we added it as the very foundation of the whole three-year program. We did make a big mistake, and originally when we started, we were doing a women's health module, so we did women's rights. And we also did, as we were doing women's rights, we thought we're going to do children's rights also. And so you can imagine what the reaction was at that time. It actually happened that men were so upset and suspicious and nervous about our teaching women's rights and children's rights that they actually even closed certain of our centers. They were constantly questioning their wives going to these classes, and we thought, okay, we've made a mistake because we realize how important it is to include men. So we changed everything around and we started talking about human rights, people's rights, instead of just women's rights or children's rights. And that totally changed everything. We also made a special effort to reach out to the religious leaders to make sure they were completely involved, that they had read all the sessions of our program. And we are now doing religious leader training because we see how important that is to bring the peers, the religious leaders who are in the same area together. We noticed that even when we did religious leader training for some of the major religious leaders who were considered the most important and most influential, that it wasn't really getting down to the village level. And they weren't sure, if I support this, will the other religious leaders in the other communities around me, I'm not sure if they've heard about this or if they will support this. So by bringing all the ones who were in the same area together and doing the training with them, it was amazing how they said, oh, okay, well, if you're doing it next door, then you will approve of me doing it. And they actually have been making declarations and have been doing sermons in the mosque on Friday on the importance of human rights and children's rights, which is very exciting also. So that was one of the biggest thing. And then the second was the community management committee trainings that we are doing now and more in depth. The Population Council also helped us with that in their evaluation. They saw that the trainings were not strong enough in order to really give the capacity they need to be able to sustain the efforts and all the activities that are begun during those 3 years. With that new training we added after that Population Council evaluation, we found there's a very big difference in the sustainability of the actions and the activities that were begun during the program, and those who have who did not do that training. So we're being sure to include that. But we have made many mistakes and have many lessons learned. Those are only two. So,
great, thank you. We'll maybe go to Annabel next on what you know. What did you learn? What didn't work, and how did you adapt it?
Yeah, I mean, as I said during my description, you know, we took these different interventions and we measured the impact of these different interventions on marriage age through population-based surveys. So we measured the impact at the level of the population as well as measuring the coverage and the cost. When we started this work, a lot of a lot of the colleagues thought that the more comprehensive model, because it has more components, would have the greatest impact, whereas it didn't. And the reason why it didn't have the greatest impact is because it had the least coverage, because the more complex model is obviously the more complicated one to implement if you're a service delivery person. So it was less effectively implemented and therefore had less impact on the age at marriage. So that sort of was counterintuitive to a number of us. The other thing that we learned also, you know, I also assumed that the educational intervention would really make a difference among particularly younger adolescents, in delaying the age at younger adolescents. Well, it did in Ethiopia, but it did not in Tanzania. And that's where it's really important to contextualize your interventions, because the status of the educational infrastructure is very different in Tanzania than it is in Ethiopia. There's been a real big push in Ethiopia to get kids into school and get kids enrolled and retain them, whereas there are lingering concerns about the educational system in Tanzania, where sometimes a teacher isn't present and there's a lot of absenteeism both of students and teachers. The educational infrastructure is just very different. So those are what we learned, some counterintuitive things and the importance of contextualizing your interventions.
Priya, Molly raised the question, how do we ensure systemic change? And you know, you alluded to the point of what actually happens to these girls after 18 with this cash transfer program, and what kind of attitude change are we really seeing? Can you speak about that a little bit more?
The objective of our program was to enhance value of girls in a society where fundamentally they're devalued. So in a very short answer, what hasn't changed is really the value of girls. I think fundamentally, girls, from the time they are born, the discourse around their sexuality, their marriage, is the predominant discourse that they grow up with. And what hasn't changed is the essentiality of marriage. Even if you're changing it by a year or year and a half, what hasn't changed is the essentiality of marriage, the essentiality of sexual purity and chastity. And because the environment is getting more and more restrictive for girls, because as they're going out in spaces where there's a predominance of young men, their mobility is getting more and more restricted. So on one hand, you're seeing the gains in education, but on the other hand, what you're seeing is greater amount of restrictions and monitoring of their movements and their mobility. So there are lots of contradictions that are happening. While there are gains in some way, there are losses for young girls in their rights and in their use of public spaces on the other hand, and I think that's the area that hasn't changed. And it won't change, or it cannot change, because we didn't do any attitudinal shifts with the program. There were not any work around how do you change gender norm expectations, how do you change attitudes. And so even in terms of sustaining these effects, I think that there's a secular shift. You will see a continued shift to delayed marriage, to school completion. But what does that extra year of not being married give to the young girl? What we are finding is that actually they're waiting to get married. The expectations have not shifted around marriage. What has become important now is education for marriageability. So what's getting linked, the communities are getting aspirational enough that they are saying it's important for me to have an educated daughter for marriage. The marriage market is much more sophisticated. They're looking for educated girls, but only educated enough to be married, but not educated more than that to be aspirational for their futures. So that hasn't changed. So what you're finding is that extra year and a year and a half of not being married, girls are enrolling into some kind of vocational studies programs or distance studies programs, because they're not allowed to go too far from home, their home. But it's not that they're really aspirational for employment, for different types of works. There aren't enough opportunities for them to think about alternatives to marriage. So that space of what is the economic space for building the economic agency for girls, I think is where a lot more work needs to be done. There's a lot of uncertainty. And parents don't feel that they want to invest enough in girls in that space, because the most important thing is that they have to get the girl married. And they don't see the return on investment to her, build her economic agency, because it's a very economic argument. What they'll tell you is, once she gets married, that money, she's not going to earn to support us. She's going to earn to support her marital family. And also, we live in a society in India where it's inappropriate for a parent to take support from their married daughter. I mean, that's customary and that's a traditional value. So none of those values have shifted enough for it to really shift what we really would say, that this additional 2 years of being unmarried should be building your skills and your capabilities to build an economic future. We don't really see that space emerging. It's a very vacuous space right now. And my answer is that we don't know enough, and we don't think that shift has happened. Much more work will need to be done to really create that economic trajectory. And I think that's where the next wave of work and thinking has to happen.
Thanks. And I mean, you know, one question that Annabel, you mentioned and others have mentioned, is the importance of context. As programs are being developed, they have to respond to the local context and the drivers and the situation of child marriage there. Are there lessons globally that can still be drawn about how we develop programs? You know, what two pieces of advice would each of you give to people developing programs based on your experiences? And I'm going to keep you short this time, because we're moving on to the group work in a couple of minutes. Yeah.
See, one of the most important lessons that we've learned is that the importance of formative research when we go into a community. Understand what are the drivers that actually lead to that. Understand also what are the opportunities that we could get to address that issues. And I cannot stress more on that, actually. And also, an ecological approach to programming, different levels. You have to approach young people differently. You have to approach zero parity couples separately. Like, for instance, we worked on newly wedded couples. We had a ceremony for them. We created a ceremony for them so that we can catch them at the right time. And they would be, in fact, be peers, or a slightly older peers, for the ones who are not married, because they're experiencing what's right and wrong. And also, engaging religious leaders is critical. And if it's not religion in that area, then at least the societal leaders, could be a village head, could be a tribal leader, who could actually be a major source of support in behavior change. That's from my side.
I would say, as I said earlier, that literally we saw almost almost like a revolution in the field. We'd been doing our program 8 years, and when we added human rights and responsibilities, education, it was unbelievable what we saw in terms of change going on, empowerment of communities, women speaking out, starting to work and work outside of the family, and actually implementing the microcredit projects that we had begun, and being able to travel. And they had never been able to do that before, but they were able to negotiate this with their husbands and their families for the first time. And we also, one of the biggest things was, for us, it was a comprehensive. I know you may not have had that experience, but we tried just doing the human rights and responsibilities and the hygiene and health modules, and we found that people were not sustaining as much their decisions. They did make a lot of decisions during that time. We have enormous change happening just after that first module on democracy and human rights, which is 5 to 6 months. But we decided that we really wanted to go for agency, that this was so critical, that the empowerment was so important, that we wanted to have the human rights, the knowledge of health and hygiene, but also that women be able to do math and to be able to manage their projects. And so the economic part, I agree, is totally, totally important, but without the empowerment side of that, I think it's critical to have the comprehensive. This is why I say this is one of the biggest lessons we learned, and we just made that decision some 10 years ago never to separate our program again, and just say it would cost less, yes, but the results, and those were evaluated actually, the 1 year versus the 3 year, and we found that it would just was not the same in terms of sustainability and in terms of empowerment for the girls and women who were involved in the program.
Thanks. What we're finding is that aspirations are changing of girls for themselves, but there aren't enough opportunities. So what we have to do is once we create any kind of social change, I think it is an obligation, it's an ethical obligation to really take things to their logical conclusion. If you're going to build the agency, you also have to create the pathways and trajectories for leading them to concrete alternatives. And I do think that empowerment and economic agency go hand in hand, and there's a huge mutual codependency of both of those processes of change, especially for young people. I think the second thing is that men are resistors and they're challengers, whether they're leaders, religious leaders, or male peers in schools. What we are finding is that for young girls, the biggest obstacles are coming from young men their age. Every day that they have to traverse public spaces, they go through the fields in rural areas to go to schools, they cross the roads. It's the boys they're scared of. It's the same age boys that they're scared of. And in our context, you see many more boys in public spaces than you see girls. So they have to, one girl who might be stepping out and crossing and challenging a boundary that has been created for her to say, I wish to go to study to high school or to college, has to go through that space. She doesn't have the same numbers of girls accompanying her. There's still the one girl or the two girls, but then there are 100 boys that are dominating those public spaces. So we have to really work with boys and men in the same spaces that we are creating change for girls.
I guess if I were to give a piece of advice to programs, I would say that at this point in our field, we really have to increase the science and the rigor and the measurement associated with these programs. Because we have this challenge right now, we have now a lot more interest in child marriage, we have more funding available to us than we had in the past. So it's our responsibility to make sure we use this moment in time to be able to scale up and as much as possible to eradicate this practice. And so that really will mean a lot more measurement, careful measurement, evidence, and rigor. So for example, we're gonna have to measure coverage because it takes place in the most remote areas and the most hard to reach areas. We're gonna have to measure coverage and reach a large percentage of girls who are at risk. And we're going to have to measure cost. It's really, really important that we are able to reach thousands and millions of girls and not just hundreds of girls. And finally, as I said from my description, what we're finding is that segmentation is important. What seems to be most effective to prevent the youngest child marriages is different than what happens when a girl reaches 16, 17, and 18, when the risk tends to intensify. Thank you.
Great, thank you. I mean, this has been an absolutely fascinating and very rich discussion, and I think it's a call to action, Annabel, for all of us there is a huge wealth of experience in the room and programming happening as well, and what kind of evidence are we able to pull from them, knowing that we need to look, we don't all have money to do long the long-term evaluation that we want to be able to do, and so what are the some of the interim steps in the meantime that can show that we're, you know, progressing along the way. And I am going to do a little pitch at this point for our theory of change, which shows kind of, you know, globally some of the steps along the way to the ultimate vision of ending child marriage and empowering girls. And we do have a list of indicators which we've been working on with many of you, and I think we have colleagues from the Aspen Institute in the room here as well, which look at, you know, what some of those steps along the way might be and what are some of the indicators that that might show us that we're progressing. I'm going to wrap up there with the panel and just thank you all so much for your input. I suspect that you probably all have questions. I've asked questions based on what you've sent, but no doubt, I hope that I can offer them up throughout the coffee breaks and the lunch breaks to continue some of these discussions. And in particular, I really encourage all of you to make the use of the open space session that we have as well. The group work that I wanted to do, I'm going to kind of take the hat of moderator off and step into facilitator, because we wanted to not just discuss content and important content lessons, but also how going forward do we share some of these lessons that we're learning, and you know, you as you're developing programs, how do you know what is most useful for you to be learning from other programs, and how can we be sharing these kind of lessons among the partnership? So I hope that you can break up into small groups. We have about 15 minutes to have, you know, small group discussions on that. I'm going to ask some of my colleagues to come up and help me just hand out the sheets. We've got a few Francophone participants. We'll give you the instructions in French, but essentially, answering those two questions. The first one, what are the specific lessons about program design that would be most useful for you to learn from other programs? And secondly, how can Girls Not Brides best facilitate this kind of learning among members? And this will be a small group discussion and a starting point of the conversation, but your input will really help us as we think about, as the partnership grows, how do we make sure that we're sharing the learning among different members? So I suggest, in the interest of time, that you stay, unless the Francophone aren't sitting together, I suggest you stay in the groups that you're in. And we have some flipboards and markers and everything, so we'll take 5 minutes to do a very short wrap-up at the end, but I'll let you just stay in your groups and have those discussions. If you have any questions, we'll be roaming around. Does anyone have any clarification questions before we start? We will hand them around to you, but the two questions, first of all, what are the specific lessons about program design that you would find most useful to learn from other programs that would be beneficial to your work? And the second, how can Girls Not Brides best facilitate this kind of learning between members? So have those discussions, brainstorm ideas, and we'll be collecting the flip charts after, and we'll have a very quick group discussion after as well. And so these ideas we'll take away, and we'll think about how we build up our work in this area. But come talk to me after as well if you'd like. I just want to flag as well, we do have a reports and publications page on our website, and we just recently launched a resource center, which is where we've got materials which members can send to us and upload, which include tools, advocacy tools, program materials, but essentially tools and resources that you think would be useful for other members. So please feel free to share, you know, your learnings with us, and we can use that as a forum, but I'm welcoming your other ideas going forward. One logistics point is that for those of you with headsets, can you please remember to hand them in so that you don't face the wrath of Samantha running around the corridor after. En français, si vous pouvez, they've got the headset. Si vous pouvez laisser les oui. Écouteurs. Bon. All right, so thanks everybody for joining. Good luck and enjoy the rest of the sessions.